The following is a presentation of TFNN. The Power Trading Hour with your host, David White. Call now, toll free at 1-877-927-6648. Internationally at 727-445-1044. Now, David White.
And welcome all to another excellent edition of the Power Trading Hour. Doesn't matter where you are, because I'm here in Florida. Best state in the union, free and getting freer. What else do we have going on today? Well, we're coming to you at this time.
The following takes place between 2 p.m. and 3 p.m.
Yeah, no, nothing? Okay. So anyway, what do we have going on today? Well, we're down 22 points, but it's not that bad. I suspect they're trying to keep the S&P and the rest of the market somewhere around the $3,900 range for expiration tomorrow. As I've said, the last few months, there have been so few puts in the market that it's hard to get a good view that we've enjoyed for years. You get a good view maybe eight times a year, which is pretty good about where the market wanted to settle. And there just isn't a lot going on. The only stock really that I've seen that I want to hang any kind of hat on for data is Apple. So we'll look at that tomorrow. But there just isn't that much out there. If you're a bookie, you want to have about half the bets on one team and half the bets on the other. And of course, the spread eventually will allow you to rake up the money, vacuum it up like a Hoover. But if you only have 10% of the people want to bet on one team, you can't take much action. They can wipe you out fairly quickly, even with points or a spread. And that is the problem here. We've got everybody on one side of the market, and that's on the bull side. But most of those calls are basically looking at the market hitting something like 3950 to 4000 on the S&P cash. So I think they're going to probably try to keep it down here. I wouldn't be surprised to see something like 3900 for the close tomorrow, but that's kind of a wag. That is a wild, I'll let you fill in the middle part, guess. And a lot of times in engineering, those are good enough to start your calculations from. But that's it. We just don't have a lot out here. Not a lot of volume up, not a lot of volume down, a lot of volume in the middle over the last few days. And doesn't really depend what you're looking at out here. It's mixed messages at best in the market. We talked about, wanted to bring that up again, and I didn't put it there. TLT at 145.41. We've been talking about that for basically the last month. And probably the more interesting thing, I had it in my newsletter this morning, The Path of Least Resistance, a newsletter available on TFNN, if you did not know. That was the rising short positions in the bonds for corporate bonds. And that is telling you something right there, and that is that it's kind of an obscure bet. So a lot of people this is the kind of people that are in the know that would probably start shorting the LQD. I guess I could pop that up, couldn't I? Should be able to. I think I have that as a thing here. We'll do that. LQD. We've talked about the bond vigilantes. And the first place it's really going to hit is corporate, because, of course, the Fed can print anything they want. But if it's going to be problematic, the first people that go hat in hand and it becoming a bigger problem to get cash certainly is not the government itself. But, of course, they when they borrow, they borrow first and make it harder on corporations to buy, and businesses, both. But you've got a kind of a long topping pattern out here in the LQD. Now, you're a little bit off, but not a whole lot. But a lot of people in the know starting to add short positions to this. You want to watch that one along with the TLT. My guess is this will be the first one to break. We had just a little over the kind of the volume we had before in the LQD back on October 30th. He had 20 million shares there. He had 21.5 million shares a couple of days ago. Now, you have kind of a light bounce, but the energy off that 137.94 high, which is on December 31st, has been more on the way down. As I said, pretty obscure to be shorting something like this, but it's risen fairly well from about 8% to, I think, 15%. Okay. And what else do we have? S&P's off 18, Dow's off 109, NASDAQ's off 102, Russell's down 30. And again, Russell probably, that would be, if the bonds really take a header here, and we see 145 give up the ghost on the TLT, start looking for that Russell to really get hit the first. So many of the small caps out there are the ones that need the money the most. If you're Apple, you got $200 billion in the bank. Not going to have to go to the well anytime soon. Not going to have to. And that's kind of it. Doesn't mean that it will do it. I'm pretty much been on the right side of the treasuries, on the bonds on that TLT, from about 158 breaking through 156 and now down to 145, and eventually probably headed for, well, I guess we can pop this up, probably that 137, 138 level. And that is where I think people are starting to worry now. But my guess is that that is when they go bat crazy, bat crazy. So we'll keep an eye on that. You can give me a call today at 877-927-6648. We got a lot of stuff going on in the market. Geopolitical events are starting to rise. and I don't know what else you can say about it other than that. Almost every president gets tested in this first few months in office. We're starting to see that with efforts to invade Taiwan by China and just a variety of different things going on. But I would say China, that diversion of looking to Russia for the big problem. Although they've been saying, look over there, the real problem's been China, and I think everybody knows it. Can't ignore it any longer. Not gonna. Don't have to. But that's about it. We've got a lot of charts to look at. We'll watch the market here as we go through the rest of the hour. But expiration tomorrow, and if something doesn't really change, it may be one of the least volatile Friday's recognition while back in
Are you grinding in the market but seeing little to no return? Or are you a successful trader simply looking to make his job a little easier? Learn to take the path of least resistance with David White's powerful trading newsletter. David White is an accomplished trader whose deep understanding of technology and the markets allows him to consistently find and share winning trades. Support and resistance define the ranges in which stocks trade. By understanding these trading ranges, David White is able to find the path of least resistance. David White's trading newsletter, The Path of Least Resistance, is delivered daily before the markets open to make every trading day an easy win. Visit TFNN.com today and subscribe to David White's Ultimate Trading Newsletter for $119 a month and try all of our newsletters risk-free with our 30-day money-back guarantee. Take the path of least resistance at TFNN, educating investors.
If you're not currently using the TAS profile scanner when looking at setting up your trading opportunities, then your arsenal is short a mighty weapon. The TAS Profile Scanner is a standalone piece of software that instantly filters over 2,500 global financial markets such as stocks, ETFs, commodity futures, and Forex. Headed by Steve Dahl, TAS understands that in today's technological world, the use of top-flight software applications and technical analysis expertise is essential to successful trading in today's market. You also gain access to the webinar that Steve Dahl and Tom O'Brien just hosted, The Best Way to Use the TAS Profile Scanner to Profit. This webinar archive is available for all subscribers immediately upon signing up. All new subscriptions also come with a 30-day money-back guarantee, so you have nothing to risk. Start your subscription by visiting the front page of TFNN.com today, and you'll find the TAS Profile Scanner under the Services tab. Sign up today.
Hey there, I'm Andy Arbertine with Tiger Precious Metals and Stones. Whether you're looking to buy and sell precious metals or trying to find the perfect diamond ring, I'm here to help. I have over 15 years of experience with diamonds and precious metals. You can call me directly at 727-329-8245, and I will personally answer any questions you have and help you find exactly what you're looking for. I will be your personal concierge in the metal and stone business. Give me a call today, 727-329-8245.
Many of our new listeners have heard about The Tiger's Den. The Tiger's Den is a lively community where professional traders and investors can meet, exchange ideas and information in a comfortable, moderated atmosphere. Hear all of the TFNN shows, plus see all of the charts as they happen live and have access to archives of all of those charts. You can test drive The Tiger's Den absolutely free for 30 days and greatly enrich your knowledge of these markets and how to make your money work for you. Details on The Tiger's Den are on the front page of TFNN.com. Call now, toll free at 1-877-927-6648. Internationally at 727-873-7618.
And it's all just a little bit of history repeating.
On this day in 1885, Mark Twain publishes his famous and famously controversial novel. I don't know why it was controversial. It wasn't controversial until late, maybe the last year. Novel of the Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. Twain, the pen name of Samuel Clemens, first introduced Huck Finn as the best friend of Tom Sawyer, the hero of his tremendously successful novel, The Adventures of Tom Sawyer. 9 years earlier, 1876. Though Twain saw Huck's story as kind of a sequel to his earlier book, the new novel was far more serious, focusing on the institution of slavery and other aspects of life in the antebellum South, which is, was in Missouri. I wouldn't really call it South, but he grew up south of St. Louis. And if anybody's been on that river, kind of muddy. They call it the Big Muddy. The old Mississippi. But I read both books, and I couldn't get enough. I probably wrote them. If I didn't read both of those 10 times, I think that's probably low as a kid. I thought that they were pretty amazing as far as the adventures and everything else. Of course, currently everybody's got an axe to grind, but I still think they're fantastic books. Somebody in the den said he finished President Grant's book, and of course Grant was dying at the time and penniless, and Mark Twain Samuel Clemens finished his book, made enough money for his wife to live, but always interesting. Okay, now let's get back to the market already in progress. Had some questions about how bad the issue is going to be with Disney. If you missed it, they got in a brouhaha over the production of what would you call it? Not the sequel, the sequelization, the spinoff, another galaxy, another universe in the Star Wars saga. And after three horribly disappointing movies for the Star Wars franchise run by the head of that whole division, I think her name is Kathleen Kennedy, pretty famous in Hollywood, one of those power players. The John Favreau, who you may remember from Swingers, really embarrassing everybody around Star Wars by making stuff that people actually wanted to watch. Oh, God forbid. So they decided to can one of the gals that was the was she like a WWF, whatever, one of those wrestling gals. And yes, she looked like she could bench press a car. So kind of fit, fit the mold. And of course, they had there was an introduction this year for her. But the eventual idea was to make a big movie, and everything has been written for her. And of course, they're starting to think that Kathleen Kennedy is trying to sabotage Jon Favreau because her movie stunk, and his series on Disney, The Mandalorian, everybody has loved. So, you know, you get into these, especially in, you know, my time out in California. You really just think that people couldn't be this kind of childish and stupid, but you would be highly underrating these folks. After they get a little money, the people in California are all about power. And the question is, how many people are they going to lose? I know that they, depending on who you listen to, lost 5 to 10 million subscribers at Disney over the issue. A lot of people ticked off. They loved their Mandalorian, and they wanted to look forward to this gal going forward. You know, they're probably, I'm not really worried about her. There's laws in California about being fired for your political position. So she'll get a big check for $10 million from Disney over the deal eventually. But a lot of people are more interested in the non-political version of them just making crappy Star Wars movies. And like I said, hard to tell, 5 to 10 million people unsubscribing from Disney. That's quite a lot, especially when you're losing money already. But don't know how far that's going to go. Generally, if Jon Favreau is saying he's not going to make the big movie, and probably not going to go back and rewrite all the stuff he did for The Mandalorian, and Kathleen Kennedy can just pound salt. So the question is, who's going to win on this? But it will probably make a fairly big dent in streaming, because other than, you know, the kids watching it, for adults above, what do you call it, somebody an adult before above 15? Or 17. Anyway, the adult demographic on Disney basically had 90% of the people watching Mandalorian and nothing else. There are a lot of other stuff that they've done, and no one has cared about it. So kind of like, remember Fox had one show that everybody watched, or two. They had Married with Children and The Simpsons, and that was it. Sunday night. And there was no reason to watch anything for like 8 years other than that on the network. But it got them through. And The Mandalorian has kind of been this for them. And I think it's the highest rated streaming show of the last year, year and a half. So kind of a big issue for Disney. Kind of the big reversal out there at 193 came with a lot of people saying they were unsubscribing to the folks. And of course, I was underwhelmed with the last three Star Wars movies. They paid $4.5 billion to get the franchise, and it was horrible, just horrible. But what can you say? Everybody's got an idea, but eventually cream rises to the top. 24, that was like 2000, like I said, I think it was like in 1992, you could watch The Simpsons and Married with Children, and those were the only two decent shows. So yeah, 24 I kind of like, but yeah, came along a lot later. Different timing. Anyway, Disney is it. Now, other people doing bad things. Facebook has got in a big brouhaha with the Australians, down a little bit today. I think this is just the dam with a crack in it, with water spilling out in the last scene of the was it the Guns of Navarone or the Bridge Too Far? Can't remember which one it was. Just remember it was I'm trying to remember. I want to say Robert Shaw, but I don't think it is. Anyway, they all had to go blow up a dam. Robert Fox set off an explosive. Everybody said nothing had happened. And about 10 minutes later, the whole dam collapses. Anyway, we'll talk about Facebook and my lack of remembering that movie when we return.
David White's newsletter, The Technology Insider, is focused like a laser on finding the next big things in technology. If you had invested only $10,000 in Microsoft in 1986, you'd have been a millionaire by 2000. Disruptive technology like Microsoft's is the key to these massive long-term profits, and The Tech Insider is the vehicle from TFNN to capitalize on these opportunities. This is the go-to newsletter that identifies, monitors, and profits on mostly little-known cutting-edge companies with great long-term prospects. David's experience is as an inventor of Emmy-winning animation products for TV and Hollywood that propelled a company public. Match that with 14 years as a full-time trader, and he's uniquely qualified to guide you through the light-speed world of ever-evolving high-tech. If you're ready to ride the next big technology bull market for less than $40 per month, log on to TFNN.com and get your 2-week free trial to the Technology Insider. Get in on the ground floor of the next big thing today.
You could be making money off the stock market. And if you're already making money off the stock market, you could be making a lot more. Check out TFNN and Tiger TV and get expert investing advice to give you the power to control your financial future. Go to TFNN.com and find the newsletter for you. Whether you're into trading gold, metals, futures, currencies, or options, you'll get advice and analysis to help you seriously get ahead. TFNN also features trading services with a 30-day money-back guarantee for new subscribers, as well as TFNN's Tiger Den Trading Room, trading software, and educational webinars for all trading levels. And make sure you check out Tiger TV for free on TFNN.com or TFNN's YouTube channel for live financial content from 8:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. Eastern on market days. Stop watching on the sidelines while other people get rich and become the investor you were born to be. TFNN, educating investors.
TFNN is excited about our new software charting program, The Art of Timing the Trade Charts. In collaboration with Tom O'Brien and using his best-selling book, The Art of Timing the Trade, Your Ultimate Trading Mastery System, David White has programmed an outstanding piece of software that will complement any trader's methodology. Using this first-of-its-kind program, The Art of Timing the Trade Charts allows you to scan thousands of stocks for Fibonacci formation setups, including Gartley's, ABC's, Butterflies, and much more. The Art of Timing the Trade Charts is designed to help you when scouring the markets for stocks just beginning to form the trading patterns that many investors spend days, weeks, or even months searching to find. And right now, we're offering licenses available at only $79 a month. We are so confident that you're going to love this new charting software that will even give you a 30-day unconditional money-back guarantee. Don't miss out on this incredible new piece of software. Get your copy of The Art of Timing the Trade Charts today by visiting TFNN.com.
This segment is brought to you by Think or Swim. For more information, just click the Think or Swim banner on the front page of TFNN.com.
And I knew I would think of it. And not on the bridge over the River Kwai. It was A Bridge Too Far, 1977. And that had... is it Sean Connery? No, that can't. No, that's another movie. Not that isn't the right one either. I'll think of it. Had the Star Wars guy, Han Solo, been in all the stuff, and a handful of other people. I'll think of it soon enough. What else do we have? Anyway, talking about Facebook, And they've unfriended Australia. Google has made a deal, and so has Microsoft with its Bing. It's all about search. Facebook has been lifting kind of first three or four paragraphs of news stories. And the idea is that if you were subscribing to fair use, then maybe you take the headline and then that's it. By taking the three or four paragraphs of the news story and actually putting it on a feed without paying the people that actually wrote it any kind of advertising, the Australians have decided that you would have to do that so that Australian journalism continues to thrive. Well, after a bunch of four-letter words, we find out that Mark Zuckerberg and his Facebook is not willing to pay it and actually threatening the heads of the government and other folks out there. So not playing well with others, maybe that's the best way to describe it. Anyway, the other folks have already made deals, including with France, on similar issues, and that is to at least give a token amount of money to anybody that actually creates any of these articles. They've skated by without making a penny, but Facebook says that we're going to make them pay. What else did I see him say? He said that they're going to hurt. So not generally something you want to hear from a CEO threatening a country with nuclear weapons, but maybe he's smarter than me. I doubt it, though. I suspect that he has, reading his own headlines, believes most of the stuff. Force 10 from Navarone. Thank you, 1978. I knew that it would come. And, yeah. So what's going forward for Facebook? I would imagine more of the same. In Florida, it is, I think we're about 2 weeks away. But there's going to be a... I think 80% of the people in the Florida State House and Congress have said that they're going to vote for it. And that is a $100,000 fine for deplatforming anybody that's on a ballot in Florida. And that would apply, of course, to Facebook and Twitter and some of the others, folks. So going to kind of cut off the way of the big social techs putting their thumb on the scale of elections going forward into the future. $100,000 a day, $700,000 a week. I wonder if that's enough. Maybe they have to make it $1 million a day or $10 million a day. I don't know what it's going to take, but I think it kind of makes me think of the old story of the guy that went bankrupt. He said it was slow and then all at once. I think, you know, between antitrust issues and everything else, just problematic. But it's not the first time. If you want to actually see what not to do in a deposition in a lawsuit on antitrust, I've always pointed out to Bill Gates in 1998. You can find it on YouTube. But this is right after the Monica Lewinsky thing. And he decided he was going to do the exact same thing as the president at the time and start arguing about the definition of what is. Of course, the judge at the time, not dealing with the president, laughed at him outright in court. And we saw the results that had to be cleaned up out of the hubris of technology. But another guy who actually believed his own press and probably should, you know, the kings used to have the fool that would tell them all kinds of horrible things about them, that they were fat and lazy and dumpy and stuff. That was the one person that couldn't get killed, although I think a lot of them did. You know, somebody... Maybe there's a position in Silicon Valley for the fool to tell these people that maybe they've gone off the deep end, jumped the shark, and I'll find a few other metaphors, but problematic at best. If sitting in Florida using a VPN and pinged as you were in Australia, would Facebook block your news? I think that's exactly the way it would work. And of course, a lot of people already have VPNs, so you can get around some of that stuff. But that would be it. Yeah. I'd had a screenshot of it, but if you go to your Facebook page today and looked in your news feed, all you'd see is a thing that's saying you couldn't do it. Did watch Australian news last night for about 10 minutes. They were out interviewing people in the street. And most of them said, you know what, I spend too much time on Facebook already. That'll just help me get off of it. But, you know, I don't think a lot of these guys are really thinking how bad it's going to get. And they really haven't changed their behavior much. Most of these stocks have not made any kind of signals that say the floor is going to come out. Twitter up a little bit on no volume today. What I would love for a lot of these, because I think they're going to come wickedly back and quickly, Twitter probably going to come back to about 62.50 just on a normal pullback. I imagine it's going to happen fairly quickly. But as soon as you get a little bit below the trend line higher, if you make one more push higher and you get the kind of light volume you get, I could easily see these things as we're probably not that far away from seeing a lot of these antitrust issues proverbially hit the fan. So, interesting. Fox has their own. I think the difference is on what it is that there is CNBC, NBC, CBS, ABC. So one network that had a different opinion is probably not a problem. I think that's probably where they would come down. But this is on the internet, and at least Twitter and Facebook both have antitrust monopoly suits against them, and that's probably where this comes from. But we shall see. Other things going on in the market. Apple, we have questions about it. And thanks again, Pat, for that. Apple continues to act poorly. There may be some reasons for it. Right now, as I said, everybody was pointing at China for the last 9 months for some reason that I was unaware of when the big threat was in China. China is threatening to cut off rare earth mineral sales to the U.S., and I suspect that's why Apple is having problems. We'll talk about that when we return.
Are you in the market for buying or selling real estate in the Bay Area, including the surrounding St. Petersburg, Tampa, and Clearwater markets? Tiger Real Estate LLC is a firm that has extensive experience in the Tampa Bay Area. Whether you're looking to sell your current property for maximum value, or you're in the market for a second home or investment property, Tiger Realty has the experience across all areas of real estate in the Tampa Bay area to help buyers and sellers make the most informed decisions across all price levels. From the price you should be paying per square foot in certain up-and-coming areas to the type of cash flow investment properties are capable of creating, Tiger Real Estate can help you make the best decision when it comes to all areas of the market. Before you make one of the biggest decisions of your financial future, call Tiger Real Estate LLC today at 727-329-8322 or email us at tiger@tfnn.com. That's 727-329-8322. Call us today.
Markets can rise and fall like the tides. Subscribe to Basil Chapman's newsletter, The Opening Call, and you too can ride the wave. Basil Chapman is an authority in technical analysis. His Chapman Wave trading system has been helping traders identify trends and capitalize on momentum in the markets since 1984. TFNN invites you to test Basil's proprietary Chapman Wave trading methodology with a monthly subscription to the Opening Call newsletter for only $149. Your subscription to the Opening Call comes with a 30-day money-back guarantee, as well as daily market updates on key indexes, stocks, and commodities. Ride the wave Sign up for the opening call risk-free today.
Are China A-shares hot or not? If you trade China A-shares, now may be time to take a closer look. Trade CHAU or CHAD, Direction's daily CSI 300 China A-share bull and bear ETFs. China A-shares in either direction. Visit directioninvestments.com today. An investor should consider the investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses of the Direction shares carefully before investing. The prospectus and summary prospectus contain this and other information about Direction shares. To obtain a prospectus or summary prospectus, please contact Direction shares at 866-476-7523. The prospectus or summary prospectus should be read carefully before investing. An investment in the funds is subject to risk, including the possible loss of principal. The funds are designed to be utilized only by sophisticated investors such as traders and active investors. Distributor Foreside Fund Services, LLC.
Don't forget, you can listen to TFNN live on your mobile device 24 hours per day. Go to TFNN.com, then hit Watch Tiger TV. That's TFNN.com, then hit Watch Tiger TV for the latest market information.
And anybody that's been around here for 10 years? I think it was 2011, 2010, something when I started the show. One of the first big stocks was MCP. It was a rare earth mineral company, and China put the squeeze on the U.S., and they're out west. I can't remember which valley or what they are. Anyway, it was a stock that went from, like, I don't know, $10 to $100, and it was one of my bigger winners in the first year of the newsletter. Talked a great deal about it on the air, but rare earth minerals, not so rare. It's just rare in any kind of concentration that makes it economical to actually mine. Of course, most of the rare earth minerals are a problem for Apple, as they need about 5 for an iPhone. And the thought is that as we make more noise about genocide and using prisoners for organ transplants from China and a variety of other things that they do horribly, that China continues to ramp up the pressure here on the United States. So right now, the discussion is whether or not there will be enough rare earth minerals for Apple to manufacture their phones. And again, since they don't have China doesn't really have to do a lot for environmental reasons, they can be the low cost manufacturer for the most part. Now, in the intervening years, Australia has become much bigger, but China has decided to lock up with the big contracts as much of that production as they can too. So there's a lot of reasons why they've kind of cornered the market on rare earth minerals. But the little thing that buzzes in your phone and kind of makes the vibration feel, the screen itself that you touch, you need, I think, 2 different rare earth minerals for that. And the thought is that maybe this brouhaha with China will come to a head and become a much bigger problem for Apple. It was kind of hard to see where this was going even a week ago, but the threats over the weekend of cutting off rare earth minerals and even the thought of cutting them off. The new jet fighter, the 35, has 700 pounds of rare earth minerals in every one of those $150 million fighters. So you can see that it is a big issue both for geopolitical or just defense needs. We do have a fairly decent known quantity in the West. Question is whether or not we choose to use that to make sure that our electronic companies actually have enough to continue. But if you kind of read between the lines, and especially in Taiwan, the thought is that China is trying to dry up that supply to put more pressure on the West. So we shall see. What else we have going on here? Take a quick look at the market. 39.15, let's call it, down 16 on the S&P cash. Market volume here today. Take a quick look at it and see. Cresting about 9.6 billion shares on the day. You know, it's probably going to be light, but shortened week, probably a lot of people on Wall Street kind of off. We are starting to look at a super barrage of SPACs that are going to be coming out maybe next week. And some of that money may be coming out of the market, too, to go after a few of those. We'll see if I can't find more about that for tomorrow's show. Again, you can give me a call, 877-927-6648. And what else do we have? Okay, Eddie says, Edie. Is it Edie? Yeah, it's Edie. Says, please don't encourage more New Yorkers to come to Florida. We will, okay. It's not bad, but still a great state and getting better. I'm just jazzed today because I can call my nephews and nieces, and they're all frozen. So, okay. Another question coming in over the email. What do I see, if any, changes in Intel? You did get close to doing a double top in Intel. You $63.56 back on January 21st. You got the new CEO. Things kind of looked a little better for a little while, but you came within, 60 cents of it. You had 87 million shares the first time, 26 million. Intel is still in trouble. I don't think that they're going to get out of it anytime soon and or easily. We talked about the one thing that they have that could turn them around rather quickly, but there's absolutely no sign of them manufacturing the MEMS resistor technology. They call it X-point memory. But there's not I don't know why, because it would make such a fantastic computer. It may just be that it takes so many things to be changed that it's going to take a while for Intel to get it out. That would mean that they could make computers incredibly faster. And I don't know if it's the expense. Generally, when new technologies come out, of course, there's a lot of problems. They've been selling a lot of it in the server space and data warehouses and cloud services, but not enough, I think, to get the price down. Maybe that's what they're waiting for. But if they got that out, then they definitely would probably be able to supplant AMD fairly quickly. AMD's been working on that same technology with Hewlett-Packard. MEMS resistors are kind of like they're memory. The difference is that they're probably going to be about 10 or 20 times faster. The memory in your computer is the slowest thing in it, other than a hard drive. And now with SSDs, memory still is the biggest spot where you could actually change how fast a computer actually worked and ran. So it continues to be an issue. Like I said, MEMS resistor technology is like memory, except when you turn the machine off, it would still be there, kind of like a USB drive, but it would be 10 times quicker than any SSD. Maybe 100 times faster than any SSD that you have today. So some lightning fast technology could change a lot, could make a lot of profit for both AMD and Intel. If I was Intel, I'd be trying to get that technology out and cheap, because it would be a earthquake in that part of the processing market. Just don't see a lot or hear a lot about it. A couple days down in advanced micro, is there a lot going on here? Don't think so. We'll look at NVIDIA.
The reality is that navigating financial markets can be risky. Markets can be chaotic and difficult to understand. Having the latest market advice can help you turn this chaos into a key for creating winning trades. At TFNN, we understand that it can be hard to find reliable market news. That's why each of our market experts offers their very own market newsletter, a must-have tool for every trader out there striving to find an edge in today's markets. TFNN newsletters cover every aspect of the markets so you can analyze the market before you trade. Try any of our great newsletters risk-free with our 30-day money-back guarantee. Just visit the newsletters tab on the front page of TFNN.com. TFNN, educating investors.
Back in the day, I joined Hotel California in 2006, and like many of you, was drawn in by
BAM!
As well as
whatever you think about, you bring about. Whatever you focus on grows.
You see, I believe that everything in life happens for us, not to us, and Tom ignited the fire within me to want to learn how to master the markets. So how did I go from knowing nothing about technical analysis to becoming the number one market timer for the S&P 500 in 2018 and the number two market timer in 2019? Simply put, I hired coaches with a proven track record, which led me to a whole new set of tools that I created to interpret the message of buyers and sellers. I would love the opportunity to teach you this award-winning set of tools and help you improve your market timing. You can test drive my newsletter service, Mastering Probabilities, for the next 30 days with no risk to you. Plus, you'll gain access to archive workshops that'll take you step-by-step through my system. Sign up today by going to the homepage of TFNN.com and selecting Mastering Probability in the newsletter tab.
Bam!
Introducing Primal Edge.
Today, it's even more important to take a supplement that complements your health. Primal Edge is specifically formulated to boost your immune system and help with weight loss, better sleep, stress reduction, and the need to detox.
Our early ancestors found all their nutritional requirements in the wild environment. But today, our food sources don't contain the vitamins, minerals, and nutrients that we need to stay healthy and strong.
That's why we need Primal Edge Daily Nutrition. It includes a special blend of ionic, soil-based vitamins, minerals, fatty and amino acids in an easy-to-use liquid form.
Primal Edge is powered by highly concentrated humic and fulvic acids, nature's preferred delivery system. They've been called miracle molecules because, like sunlight, air, and water, without them, life cannot exist.
That's right, Ellen. They ensure we receive all the nutrition we need to be healthy and thrive.
We take it every morning.
Primal Edge, just $89, exclusively at TFNN.com.
Catch Tom O'Brien, professional trader and educator, founder of TFNN, also a special guest on CNBC. Tom will bisect and dissect the markets. The Tom O'Brien Show, next on TFNN.
And we're going to look at NVIDIA here as we leave. Had a nice little run back up at the top. The production issues, if your product wasn't made in South Korea, it was made in Taiwan. If it's any kind of high-tech equipment designed in the last couple of years, like a Samsung phone or an Apple iPhone, if it's hot, expensive, it was made in Taiwan. The chips were at least maybe assembled in China or South Korea. Also, the big memory or any of the NVIDIA cards, which are, I think, except for a little bit of memory, are all made in Taiwan, is a problem. Now, this tried to break out, never really got a big sign of strength, although it kind of started to on the drive back up, back into the trading range today. These all probably have bright futures if you can get production going back on. But I think you have to be a little concerned when China has jet fighters flying into the airspace of Taiwan. They're doing that to either, one, get ready to invade, or two, to threaten and cajole Taiwan into some kind of deal. Don't know. I haven't watched it close enough. It is problematic. You have a doji out here that generally is the halfway move, technically, from the top to the bottom. So if you've got about 30 points from the top to the bottom. You look another 30 points below. If this thing breaks at all tomorrow, that could be back down to your about 550 area. Actually, that wouldn't be too bad because you'd find the big day of the 8th of February. That was 10.8 million shares. If you could get back into there with some light volume, I mean, it's not big today, but if you could kind of drift back down into, let's call it 565-ish, that may be kind of interesting, maybe 570 on light volume if you got down there. You have kind of blown off the top. Sell when you can, not when you have to. We'll see you here tomorrow. Same bat channel, same bat time.